Welcome to the Select Board meeting tonight. Thank you, everyone, for coming out. And I, again, want to make sure that our interview committee is thanked for a lot of the work and effort they made to make this happen tonight. We have John Cordaire, who volunteered, Trevor, Dick Halaszewski in the back, and, oh, on the side, he moved, and Brenda Hill, our town accountant, and then John Pachorik, our chief. So thank you all for coming, and I really appreciate it. And I will turn it over to Wendy to introduce our candidates.
Okay, I'm Wendy Foxman. I was assisting the town and the committee with the screening process and the overall search process. And just by way of background, the search resulted in, I think, 9 applicants, and the committee interviewed 6. And really deliberated, had several meetings, and recommended 4, as you've probably read in the newspaper. One of the finalists did pull out, found another position, and let us know that yesterday. So for those of you who are wondering, that's what happened. So just, first of all, I'll introduce the candidates here tonight. I'll do this in alphabetical order. Ira Brzezinski, Natasha Now, and Casey Warren. Did I pronounce your last name right, Natasha?
Correct.
Thank you.
Yes.
Okay, so the procedure for this evening is the board will ask questions of the candidates, all the questions, not in the order. You won't be asked the same question in the same order, but you will be all asked the same question at some point. And then if there's time, and hopefully there will be time, some people have already submitted questions, I'll take them, and I've got cards and pens here. I'm just going to make sure that they're appropriate to be asked. I'm sure they will be. This town has been through this before and done a very nice job with that. So unless there's a question or anything else you'd like me to address.
No, we can start.
Okay.
I actually am starting off with the first couple questions. You each bring different experience to this position. And Natasha, I was going to have you start with, what do you bring to the town of Deerfield and the position of town administrator from your background and experience?
Do I have to push?
Nope.
No.
Thank you. For Deerfield, I bring a couple things. I have a town administrator background. I worked for a very small town in Connecticut, similar size to Deerfield, the town of Columbia, Connecticut, population about 5,400. I worked there for the last year, from April to April of this past year. And it had similar complexity, so I would be very familiar and adept at dealing with, you know, the senior center and the services it provides there, the library, public works, recreation. We had pretty much identical departments. We also had assessing there for taxes. We had the tax collector. That was probably the only difference of positions. We had a separate tax collector and clerk. But I worked there for the last year and dealt with a lot of different projects. I'm very good with capital projects. I noticed that you were working on a library expansion, which is actually the project I was working on this past year. We were dealing with renovation and expansion there. And I was dealing with the architect and all that had to go into it with the project planning. We had to regrade a beach there. We had a lot of projects going on, expanding our park. I had experience in dealing with a lot of infrastructure, paving. We redid 2 bridges while I was there, you know, meeting with the developers and the builders and making sure it's staying on course and, you know, whatever needs to be done, be done, and whoever needs to get together to speak with each other. I'm big on collaboration. I think that's something that I would bring to the town, making sure that the communication is consistent and clear. I think I elaborated that on my first interview. You're going to get honesty with me. That's, more of a personal trait than experience, but I think that plays into the job very, very much so. Because, you know, it is a job. You're here to do a job and get things done. But at the same time, obviously forming the relationships with residents and the staff is extremely important. I'll jump back. The other thing that I bring to the table for Deerfield is my financial experience. Prior to Columbia, I was a finance HR director for the town of London Grove, which is a very small township in Pennsylvania. They were about 8,000, a little bit larger, but also same complexity, had similar departments, not exactly the same, but I handled all the HR for that town, did all the payroll, all the benefits administration, all of the budgeting. Likewise with Columbia, I'm just kind of trying to hit the high points so we don't go too long. And basically acted as an assistant manager there. The manager there and I got along very well, and he relied on me for some input with, you know, it ranged from finance to HR to stormwater management. I mean, I got thrown into pretty much everything. So I guess I would consider myself a public administration generalist, which I think is typically what you see with manager or administrators. Have I had experience in everything? Obviously not. Everyone can see that I'm of the younger variety. So I would, you know, definitely appreciate some help as if, you know, if I were to start here and get my feet wet. But I think I do provide some passion for Deerfield and am very energetic. I'm just always trying to go for the goal, is I guess is what I would say. So
thank you.
Ira, how do you envision working with department heads and other town employees and other boards and officials?
My background, as you know, and perhaps others do as well, is one in terms of local government, where I've been on the, where you are. I've served on numerous elected and appointed boards, from going back to my PTO days in the mid-80s to 10 years on the school committee, starting in 94, 6 years in finance. I've been on capital planning. I'm on the select board in South Hadley now. So my perspective is one that requires a great deal of collaboration. I understand that local government, for all of its things that don't necessarily work great, what's most important is that there's collaboration, that people are brought along so that they understand why things are a particular way, so that people are invited to be to provide solutions and to be part of the process. When I got here, there were two or three or four people that all said, when I introduced myself or they introduced themselves, they said that they were a troublemaker. And those are that's what local government's all about, that particularly in small towns, nothing happens without those, quote, troublemakers. And they're not troublemakers. They're people that see things a particular way, that have a particular experience that's important. In terms of working both with the professional staff, within town government, with constituents, whether they be taxpayers or simply residents, it's important to understand where people are coming from. As the town administrator, I think the most important role is to give everybody a place at the table, to make people feel that that what they have to say is important, and to act on what is being said. I think that's the most important thing that a town administrator can do. In terms of the professional staff, it's very important for the administrator to be supportive, to be a mentor or a mentee. As you can see from my resume, I have zero professional experience in local government. All of my experience has been on the other side of that table. So I have a particular perspective about things. On the other hand, I have decades of experience in private business where I've had to do comparable, sometimes similar, but certainly comparable things that an administrator would do in a public role. So I bring a set of experiences that are certainly different than the typical applicant would be. I think it gives me the perspective that allows me to think sometimes out of the box, so to speak. I think that if you were to speak to people in the community that I come from and where I've served on, you know, for so many years, Probably one of the things that lots of people would say is that I do listen, and that that's important. It's important to me.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ira.
I know we met first.
I'm sure. Casey, tell us about your experience in municipal budgeting and finance, public procurement, human resources, collective bargaining, grant writing, grant administration, town meeting, warrant preparation, regional services. So speak for the
That's a long list.
I don't know how that question got so big. No. Tell us about yourself.
Tell us questions. About yourself. So I'll try to start from the top. That is a long list.
It is a long list. Tell us what you do.
Municipal budgeting. I have done both things, the assistance piece of it, where I worked for a town administrator, several actually, and assisted them to create new processes and to work through the general budget input, data input, that sort of thing, and bringing a document together to hand to the finance committee as well as handing it to the selectmen and then moving through the process to a final document that goes before town meeting. But I've also worked on the administrator side of that, which is working to develop the relationships that take on the budget itself. You sit, you work with finance committees, you work with your selectmen, you work with the department heads and with the committees who have a stake in that larger budget. And there's a piece that always comes in from capital, which in Deerfield can be in all communities. I know the community I work in now, they are just building a capital plan. So capital is a piece of it. The human resources part of developing all of those numbers is a piece of it. But ultimately, developing that budget is going to come through collaboration. So that tends to be the place where you take your budget and finally present to town meeting. You may have to remind me what the rest of those are.
Remind myself. Municipal budgeting and finance, like public procurement, human resource, collective bargaining, just kind of different aspects of the job.
So human resources, I've had some experience both from a training perspective and boots on the ground, so to speak, working with some of my peers who have mentored me along the way, but also in various aspects of HR that even the difficult ones that help you grow as a manager and learn to take on the HR responsibility. The background of the HR responsibilities is often collaborating with my peers, as well as the people that handle such things as benefits in a town hall to address problems and situations that come up in any town. Procurement is something that I've been growing my skills in for several years. I've taken two of the procurement requirements for the Massachusetts public procurement official certification and just finished the last one, which is design and construction, and I'm pretty sure my head fell off when I was done. It's very complex. The good news is there's a lot of assistance out there for many towns, just in case anybody needs to know. But it is more complex than it used to be with the changes from the Municipal Modernization Bill. Right. So it's created quite a bit of time and catch up. The other good news is the IG is helpful. Yes. So it varies in terms of procurements. I've worked on classification studies. I've worked on larger projects like building construction projects, and in fact that's one of the items on my list of things to do right now is work through that very confusing difference between building and supplies and services.
Right. Thank you.
Did I hit as many as I could?
Yeah, pretty close.
Thank you. Let's see.
Yes,
I'm next. Natasha, what would you do in your first 2 weeks on the position?
So it's interesting in that I would have had a different response to you a year ago.
Right.
I think we spoke about this in the first interview. Something I like to do is provide a 90-day plan. It's something that I worked with a mentor many years ago, and it was a great suggestion. And that plan would have looked different a year ago. I would have said, I'm going to start making these changes and doing all of these things to improve this efficiency and, you know, what have you. I found with my experience at the last job as town administrator for Columbia, Connecticut, that you really need to focus the first 2 weeks. I mean, before you get to the job, you need to read and you need to be informed on what the town is about, budget, you know, HR. You need to come in with the information. But the first 2 weeks is getting familiar with all the committees and everyone that you're going to be dealing with. I mean, I think building relationships is step number one. You have to make time out of the day to meet with residents and, you know, get familiar with everyone. If you don't have that as a base, you know, it can be misconstrued as you don't care to do that. Mm-hmm. And I think that that's the number one important thing to do is to schedule some type of retreat, if the select board would so allow me to do so, with the staff, where it's you have an idea of who everyone is and what they're responsible for. You know, I can't assume that. I have to and hear that from the employees and the committees. So to have a chance to introduce myself and have them tell me, you know, how Deerfield works, because I'm not going to come in and tell them how it works.
Right.
I'm coming into a situation where I have to mold myself to who is here already. So relationship building it would take a full 2 weeks.
Right. Thank you.
But obviously anything else that came up you'd have to deal with, because you can't ignore it.
Ira, what are your thoughts on performance evaluation? And what process would you follow to set objectives and monitor performance?
Performance evaluation is something in South Hadley that we do. It really depends on the particular environment and department when it comes to working with employees who might be part of a union. There's one way that that sort of thing is handled. It is, of course, negotiated. When it comes to working with people that are on individual contracts or perhaps not on a contract, you still negotiate, sort of. I mean, you do. And you want to come up with something that works for everybody. You want to have a system. I guess I should back up, and I should say that I am in favor of, and I'm an advocate for, performance-based evaluations. I think it's very important. But I think it has to be something where everybody has a piece. It can't be something that is just handed down and, you know, this is the evaluation and this is the way it's going to be done. It has to be something where the person who's being evaluated also has the opportunity to evaluate themselves. So there has to be a process where there's ownership by everyone, and that the result of it is positive in almost all situations, and it's something that allows people to grow. So the evaluation should go from year to year to year. There has to be some continuity there. There has to be metrics that are in place that are consistent. And goals and objectives for individuals or groups of individuals that are also consistent, and so that people aren't from year to year being bounced from one side to the other and not really totally understanding what it is that's being expected. So communication is very, very important with everything in public government, well, in government. It's particularly important when it comes to what we're talking about here, which means everything to certainly to the person that's being evaluated, and in the bigger picture, the goal is to have the best possible execution of individuals' performance of the jobs that are being done, and ultimately the services that are being provided to the community. I mean, everything ultimately ends up there.
Thank you. Casey, how would you go about assessing the strengths and weaknesses of this organization and identifying opportunities for improvement?
I think the first place to start is to get a sense.
Yeah, I don't think it's on. I'm not sure.
No, I think it's. Can you hear me?
Yeah, yep. I did hear it.
Okay. Maybe that'll be better. So I think the first thing, can you hear me?
We can.
All right, Chris.
There we go.
All right, let's try this again. So I think the first place to start is to get an idea of the organization itself. So from my perspective, I would need to sit down with the Board of Selectmen and find out what your priorities are, because that's going to play a large role in how to approach the rest of the organization. And the next step for me would be to sit down with the department heads. I think I would want to do that both in a group atmosphere, but also individually, because they each bring something to the table that they may want to have a conversation about with me directly. Then the committees and boards are very important in how the overall organization works. So, but that's a twofold approach, because the committees themselves collectively bring a certain amount of information and attention to the table, but each chair, as the director of that committee, may have perspective that they would like to share. So in order to really get an idea of and to evaluate the organization, I think we need some metrics, and then develop some form of report for myself to then approach a way to present my thoughts, if that is something that the board wants me to do. Otherwise, I take that information and start to create a strategic plan as to how to approach what we know is coming up for projects, because a lot of these committees play a part in the larger role, such as budgeting.
Thank you.
Thank you. Is that me again? Okay. Natasha, how do you set priorities? What do you see as the most pressing issues facing the town of Deerfield?
I think priorities, it's an interesting thing, because I think the budget drives priorities most of the time, and sometimes the items that get less money get less attention, which is unfortunate. You kind of have to look at every spectrum while you're trying to do this. But obviously, you know, you're looking for your Tilton Library to do an addition there. That would be a project that would, as far as, I don't know what status is right this second, but I do know that that's something that's coming up for you. You know, you're obviously maintaining your fleet of vehicles, making sure the Public Works Department is taken care of with their materials and supplies. I think that's number one with the winter coming up, making sure we have salt, making sure everything's set for that. All of the plows are in order and everything's working. I'm sure the Public Works Director is on top of that already. And the roof project, I think you're still working on, the DES roof project?
Just finished up.
Just finished up that? Okay. and I know that there was a lift station engineering study that was going on, too. I'm not sure how much involvement I would have in that. I just noticed, you know, on the website that there are certain projects that are going on right now. I think the elementary school construction was going on over the summer. I'm not sure if that's completed, if we need to wrap stuff up with that. And I know that you're trying to institute that buy recycled policy. I think that was another initiative that was going on. And then obviously, you know, anything with the building department, any new businesses that are coming in, I know I'm aware of there's some vacancies going on in town. That would be something that I would want to make a priority if the select board wanted to do so, is to increase economic development. But number one is to make sure the operations are running smooth. I mean, you can't start new initiatives before you've kind of taken care of what's existing. Taking on too much on the plate is something that I probably am guilty of from time to time, because everything is so exciting, you know, trying to get this grant done or this project done, but making sure that you finish one thing and move on to the next, within reason, of course, because this job is a lot of simultaneous work. Yeah. But
thank you.
Ira, we've asked this question already, but you each bring a different experience to this position. What do you bring to the town of Deerfield and the position of administrator?
So as I mentioned before, my resume is very different from the from most applicants to a job like this. What I bring is decades of experience on the government side, working with groups, working with boards, both elected and appointed, in very diverse environments. So from 10 years on our school committee in South Hadley to followed by 6 years on our appropriations committee, you call it the finance committee, to the last 4+ years on the select board, I've seen how our town government works from every angle, with the exception of actually being paid to do the work. So I bring that perspective. I also bring a perspective of going all the way back to 1994 when I was first elected to our school committee, which just so happened to have come 1 year after the implementation of the Education Reform Act, which turned everything about public education in Massachusetts on its head, to looking at different ways of getting the job done, different ways of interaction between the professionals, the administrators, and folks that do the work, to the people that set policy, and as you do. So I think I have a very good handle on that from those days to more recent times, again, in the community that I come from, where we went through a very intensive process 5 to 6 years ago, where we tweaked and changed our form of government a bit. We didn't change the number of people on the select board. We kept with, we have a representative town meeting, but we reduced it. We did a lot of things, but the most important thing that we did was to look very carefully at the roles and responsibilities of the board and the town administrator. And it actually resulted in home rule legislation passed by our town meeting and ultimately went to the State House. That made some significant changes in the way we do business, and that's not to say that what we did is the only way, or maybe even the best way. But all I can tell you is that in asking the question, what do I bring? So I bring that experience and that perspective from my professional career, from what I do for a living. I'm in private business. I've been doing that since 1986 as a small business owner, entrepreneur. You couldn't have a more different environment than the environment that you work in here, and that we all throughout the state and the country work in terms of trying to make the trains run on time. In our communities. It's very, very different. So while I don't have the experience of being an administrator in a public environment, I have done all of the sorts of things that small business people do to survive and at times to thrive and to keep to keep that going. So I bring that perspective, which allows me to think from time to time about, is there a better way for government to do something than maybe the way it's being done, and, and still within the parameters of what the law allows. And sometimes I've taken my government experience and used it to help with my business. So they're very, very different. There's a reason why I own a business in Greenfield and Brattleboro, and I live in South Hadley, and I've never opened a business in South Hadley. I don't see how I could have done both and remain sane. So I kept them separate, but I have both of those sets of experiences.
Thank you. Casey, how do you envision working with the department heads, other town employees, and elected officials?
My management style tends to be very collaborative. So the approach is often from an individual perspective and then a group perspective. I find it very useful to meet with people to get an idea of how they think about something or what they think about something one-on-one, but also to bring that to a table because each of us brings something to the table that can better help the group make a determination. And I think that's very important. Communication is a key piece of running any town, particularly when there are so many pieces to the puzzle. You've got so many boards and committees that play a part in how this government runs. And in Massachusetts, it's further complicated by regionalization and this push towards regionalization that we're experiencing now. And changes in the federal government, changes in our economic status. So my approach tends to shift toward making these ideas and helping people understand them very well so that we can approach it proactively as opposed to reactively.
Thank you.
You get the mouthful question here. Tell us your experience with municipal budgeting and finance, public procurement, human resources, collective bargaining, grant writing and grant administration, town meeting, warrant preparation, and regionalization services. Pick any one of those.
Okay, I'll for sake of variety, I'll start backwards. regionalization, this is also something that Connecticut as a state is trying to encourage, similar to Massachusetts. Right now there's 169 municipalities with no county government in Connecticut. Mm-hmm. So I think I saw and was participating in the managers kind of instituting that and saying, you know, we're going to start our own regional kind of plan here. We're going to share services. We're going to share vehicles. We're going to share equipment. So I definitely have that collaborative approach. I always try to not only make relationships within the organization, but also network outside because that's so important. For, you know, you just get ideas, you know, this town is working on this project, you know, and they've had this success or this failure, and you can learn from that. So operating in your own little silo or bubble or what have you is never a good thing. So regionalization would be something I would try to encourage and work on or enhance if needed in Deerfield. The one before it, I believe, was grant writing?
Yes.
Grant writing, as one of my environmental advisory committee members had said, I'm a grant writing machine. that nice. Was one of the things that Columbia really strived to do. They did not want to spend a lot of money, and since there is a lot of money available to go after that money, rightfully so. I applied for a number of grants while I was there, which actually they were awarded since I had left the position. One was a senior transportation van. Connecticut's big on having 12 passenger or larger vans to transport disabled or just immobile seniors to get groceries, to go to doctor's appointments. So now they're looking to purchase the van with the money that we were awarded through that grant. I worked on that grant with help. All of these grants you cannot do yourself. That's the main thing to emphasize here. The Commission on Aging was a big help in that grant writing. The second grant I worked on was it was an energy initiative. It was for the Clean Energy Community Program through Eversource, which was the energy provider in the state of Connecticut. They're trying to promote communities working on solar, working on other kind of energy reduction methods, one of which is a light bulb exchange event. So we applied for a grant and got $5,000 to put on an event for the community where residents could come and exchange incandescent light bulbs for LED light bulbs, which was really great. We had a huge turnout. It was a very, very nice event. Part of that grant, it kind of got rolled into another one. We had won some money for waste reduction. The state of Connecticut is trying to emphasize waste reduction efforts. A lot of people are considering composting activities now. I could not get a composter for the transfer station, unfortunately. It was just too expensive. It was outside the grant scope. Yeah. But we did raffle off individual composters, and residents were able to put their name in and win a composter. So that was part of that big grant. And then trying to think of the other grants. We worked on a high-risk rural roads grant. You have the DOT come in and do an inspection of all of your roads, which is really, really phenomenal. It's hard to get DOT's time. Yeah. In the state of Connecticut. So getting someone to come out and say, you know, this sign is out of code, or this, you know, miles per hour for this road is inadequate. We have to, you know, raise it or lower it. Or we need to look at this intersection. We had a fatality in the town. And so we were awarded this audit, which was fantastic. And now they're going to help us, or I should say I'm no longer there, help Columbia institute some of those initiatives. I worked on a lot of grants while I was in London Grove in Pennsylvania as well. As the finance director, I had all the numbers, so sometimes the manager would throw that duty on me as the finance director, but he would ultimately work on it with me. So I had less of a leadership role there and more of a leadership role in Columbia. For the next one was...
There was a warrant preparation, town meeting warrant preparation.
Town meeting warrant?
And warrant preparation, like the warrants for the town meeting.
Oh. Meaning just advertising for the meeting, or?
No, they're the questions that go before the town for voters to vote on.
Oh, okay. We call it something different in Connecticut. I wasn't understanding. So we have a very similar form of government in Columbia, Connecticut, where I last worked, town meeting form. We had a select board, but it was a 5-member board instead of a 3-member. But it was my duty to advertise all the meetings with the help of my assistant at the time, and to make sure that the question was phrased correctly, because you have to re-advertise the entire meeting legally 30 days from the date of the meeting. Yeah. So I would say I had less experience in that because that was more of a clerical role in our organization there.
Okay.
But the town meeting form of government was, I was responsible for meeting with the first selectman and putting the agenda together.
Yeah.
Most of the items came from me because I was in the office full time, but she would of course have items that came to her from residents, or she was talking to other selectmen in the area and wanted, you know, a certain agenda item on there. So we would form the agenda together, I would post it, and we would go on with the meeting. But
great, thank you.
And then there was a couple other, I know.
Let's see.
Budgeting.
Public budgeting, finance.
So Columbia has an almost identical budget to Deerfield. It was about 13-ish million with the school and the municipal budget combined. I put that together with the finance director. She and I met, and I met with each department head separately. The department head met with their administrative assistant prior to our meeting together, and then we met and went over their section of the budget. And I would ask questions, you know, well, why did this increase? Why did that decrease? And they were, you know, the staff there was phenomenal. They were always prepared. They always had a reason why. Oh, well, the subscription for this company increased. I mean, we had to go line by line, which is, I'm assuming, what would be expected here. So I had that experience with the $3.5 million operating budget, and then as well as the capital budget. I did something that I did for Columbia as I did for London Grove. I'm really big into capital projects. That's one of my passions, is to make sure that the town is looking forward to the future and not just... Unfortunately, I've seen, at least in my little experience, towns have a tendency to operate in the now, or maybe just looking out 3 years, which is, it's hard. It's definitely hard to do, and it takes time to plan, but, you know, it's a detriment to the town to not look out at least 10 years, because you have equipment, you have trucks, you have infrastructure that you need to maintain. So I would always try to institute a 10-year capital plan, and neither Columbia nor London Grove had that before I got there. So just making sure, you know, a certain road needed to be paved. And we, of course, are estimating because the paving costs and everything obviously inflates as 10 years goes by. But you had an idea, so maybe you had to think about increasing taxes in 5 years. Or maybe you could do a better job and figure out how to not increase taxes at that time and plan for it and maybe sock away money or, you know, maybe consider taking out a small loan or a bond if necessary, but obviously doing that at the last, you know, the last option, trying to maintain the level of service and, you know, still have an outward approach saying we need to buy this truck in 2023.
Sorry. Thank you. Let's see. And then Ira, what would you do on your first 2 weeks on the job?
A whole lot of listening.
Yep.
I would be sure, if not within the first week, certainly within the first 2 weeks, to meet with every department head. I think that's very, very doable in this in this community. And to meet with every board chair at a minimum. Every day of those first 2 weeks, of course, there's the day-to-day things that, that would need to get done that are being done now, so I would assume that they would continue to be done, but would be asking lots of questions, meeting with lots of people, both within this building or other buildings, but within government, as well as within the community. Meeting with folks that are involved in business in the community, I think is really a high priority. You folks actually have a significantly higher level in terms of taxation and just in terms of business presence than you know, for the size of the town, for the size of the budget, the size of the population, than many, many, many other communities, certainly communities of similar size, but also communities of even larger size. And that's a real plus. And I know that everybody makes their assessment about the way things are from their own perspective, and sometimes it's a little more global, and oftentimes it's very, very local, and is not comparing with what's going on in other places. But I think your percentage of taxation from commercial enterprise is over 20%, something a little bit over 20% perhaps. And that's really excellent. And so that's something that really would need to be fostered. But getting back to, you know, the first 2 weeks, just doing an awful lot of listening. And beyond those 2 weeks, you know, it takes, you know, probably more like 60 days, particularly for somebody that's coming in that, you know, has not been here before. But if there's going to be collaboration and if there's going to be a sense of ownership of what is happening and what will be happening, then it's important that people be listened to.
Thank you. Thanks. Thank you very much.
Casey, what are your thoughts on a performance evaluations, and what process would you follow to set objectives and monitor performance?
I think performance evaluations are very useful for two reasons, because it allows goal setting for the employee, a sense of collaboration with the employee, and sets a time frame by which you can meet expectations. So from my perspective, I think performance evaluation should be done 3 times a year. You get the beginning of the year, and in this case we mean fiscal years, beginning of the year, with some evaluation of where that person is and what kind of goals could be met in the next 6 months. And then a mid-year evaluation where you determine how those goals have been met. Are there other things that need to be factored in to what you laid out at the first evaluation? And then at the end of the year, you go back and you evaluate what the timeline has had as an effect, where the person is, and what might be things that could be worked on as you approach that next year. But more importantly, I think performance evaluations are useful on both sides of the table. I think it's great for the supervisor to get a sense of what the employee thinks, how the employee wants to approach this, because often it's a scary thing. I've always seen them as very positive, but I've always looked at them as a way to learn. So I think the best thing that a person can do, because of how people are often scared of performance evaluations, the best thing you can do is set the standard that this is a positive interaction and that it's meant to help all of us grow and thereby grow the organization.
Thank you.
Thanks. Natasha, how would you go about assessing the strengths and weaknesses of this organization and identify opportunities to improve?
I think you would start with a traditional SWOT analysis. That's something that they teach you in your master's program or, I guess, your undergrad. To gather that information, it might sound like I'm echoing the prior responses, but it is, in fact, what I would do and what I have done in the past is to identify with each department head, probably starting off. You know, I understand I'll meet with the select board even before this, but to get a feel for how each department head feels their department is running and, you know, what they contribute to the town. And if, you know, maybe there is a project that didn't work, you know, not pushing it to the side and ignoring it, but say, why did it not work? You know, maybe if we try this differently, will it work and will it succeed? Is it something we want to pursue? So I think even if there's assistance in the departments along with the department heads, having their input too is important, especially because I think sometimes there's a facade that, you know, not every voice is heard, so making sure that everyone has an opportunity to have their opinion put in, but having them also understand that it's not necessarily going to go through just because they want it to. You know, there's a bunch of ideas on the table. We're going to sort through them and then see how things go. But I think one of the important things to do, which we did in London Grove during budget season, which was very successful, is to have a time outside of a council meeting such as this to have, we called it coffee with the town manager, we called it coffee and donuts or something, you know, some kind of informal setting where you can gather at maybe a local restaurant if they'll have you and have residents come by and feel, you know, like they have input. We just did it very, very normal style with, you know, a whiteboard or a piece of paper, and we had an easel, and we had probably 15 residents show up. It wasn't, you know, a large turnout, but sometimes when you're getting these programs off the ground, it takes a little while. But I think it was a really good way to say, you know, what do you think is a priority, and what do you think this town does well, and what do you think this town doesn't do well? So, you know, we got a lot of great input on certain roads that weren't on our radar that we needed to think about maybe at least patching for potholes and stuff like that. But we got a lot of good compliments saying this is what we feel like the town is doing well, because as we know, sometimes we feel like all we're doing is getting the complaining phone calls. So it's nice to identify the strengths and run off of those and then say, what do we need to work on from the resident perspective? Because we kind of get into our own little world in town government, and, you know, we think that, you know, we have everyone's best interest in mind, and sometimes there's perspectives that are being missed, you know, from the resident perspective. So just having that informal meeting where people can feel like they can give their thoughts. But
that's good.
Thank you.
Thank you. Ira, how do you set priorities, and what do you see as the most pressing issues facing the town of Deerfield?
It's hard for me to say exactly what the most pressing issues are. Mm-hmm. As with any community, there are lots of issues that are important, some more important than others. Certainly getting that bridge back open is a is a priority. It would be hard for me to say as an outsider exactly what the most pressing issues are. But I think it's, again, I come back to just listening and getting feedback from as many different stakeholders as is possible to understand where things are. I think that in terms of just a little bit more globally, rather than talking about specifics for Deerfield, the most important, there are three things. There are kind of three pillars that I think with, for any organization, large, small, public, private, really doesn't matter, that I think are most important. The first is that the organization has to understand its core competency, and it has to focus on that. If there are weaknesses, they have to be strengthened. If there are strengths, they have to be enhanced even more. The second is that there needs to be a clear understanding of what process is. There can't be shortcuts, particularly in government, you know, where you know we operate in a fishbowl and everybody can see and should see everything. So it's important that that process be followed and that it be consistent and that we not take shortcuts. And the last is communicate. Internally, externally, residents, business, the educational community, which is of course ultra important in this community in particular, and then communicating inside to make sure that boards are communicating with staff, communicating with administrators, and vice versa, that all of that is happening as effectively and seamlessly as possible. And that's not always easy. So in terms of the specifics of what is most important, I think that kind of goes hand in hand with what do you do in the first 2 weeks or the first 2 months. It's really difficult, for me anyway, to make that specific determination.
Thank you.
Casey, each of you have your experience and bring different experiences to the position. What would you bring back to Deerfield and the position of town administrator?
I think I bring, still working on this mic thing. I think I bring a more well-rounded approach to local government. I have several years of experience in various disciplines in local government, but most recently in the administrative piece of this whole pie. And it is important to understand that how you learn and what you take out of different experiences grows your skills, but it also grows your understanding of how to move forward. So for me, I bring a better understanding of what resources mean to a town. I bring a better understanding of the fact that infrastructure is the underlying piece of any successful town. Infrastructure doesn't just mean the roads. It means buildings. It means how the human factor is dealt with. It means communication with the residents. It requires a varied approach. So that type of skill set, those types of competencies are things that I can bring to the table that maybe 3 years ago I might not have been able to bring. So as I learn and grow, as I challenge myself to turn some of the challenges that life throws at you into positive aspects of myself as a person, I realize that there's a lot more that makes me a candidate to meet challenges that I see coming up in Deerfield or that already exist in Deerfield. So from a budgeting perspective, a whole different kettle of fish exists outside of Deerfield, where other towns face such issues as Proposition 2.5, regular debt exclusions, setting up their bylaws to handle specific positions such as a town administrator's position. All of those experiences have created a different response in me and the ability to make myself a better employee and a better person to handle what I think Deerfield has ahead of it.
Thank you.
Natasha, how do you envision working with department heads and other town employees and town officials?
So I've learned a lot in the last year in regards to this kind of relationship building and communication skills. I think, you know, having that open door policy is very important to feel that you're approachable. I've, you know, dealt with people that have a different management style than me, and I can see how it works and it doesn't work and how mine works and doesn't work. But I would say, you know, I'm extremely straightforward. You know, I'm not going to skirt around stuff. I'm not going to try to, you know, make things more palatable for someone in that, you know, we don't get things done because of it. So I think saying the hard things sometimes is part of the job, and that is part of the difficulties sometimes with dealing with department heads. Not that I want that. I want, of course, to have an easy working relationship with every single staff person, but it's not going to happen. I mean, there are going to be issues that are going to come up that we're going to have disagreements on. But the important thing is to understand why and to sit down and have those meetings. Sometimes we get caught up in this email world and things get misinterpreted. And I think having that face-to-face time with department heads and everyone in the organization is important, and making time for that. And sometimes that means you don't leave the office until 9 or 10 o'clock at night because you have a deadline to meet and these people to meet with. But you have to make yourself available and make it so that they're always feeling like they're being heard, especially when, you know, HR issues come up. I dealt with a lot of HR issues that I can lend my experience to Deerfield from Columbia. We dealt with a lot of union and non-union issues there. We had a administrative assistant union. There were 6 members, and that was the only union. But people felt as though they were treated differently. And there was there was hostile environments and hostile relationships. And I think I have had a lot of practice in that. And if that were to come up, I could lend some expertise there. But what I've learned from all that is open and clear communication. And I think that, you know, just sitting down with committee members and hearing what they have to say, or making sure you go to all of those meetings, like we were saying in the first 2 weeks, what would you do? I think it's important not only to meet with department heads and all the employees in the select board, but also to get an idea what, you know, each committee does and go to their meeting and make yourself available. You know, you can't do that all the time, all day, every day, because you'll burn yourself out. But I think always making yourself available and having that open communication factor, even if it is just email, making sure that person knows that that email is important to you and you're going to respond in a timely manner, because we need to get things accomplished and everyone needs to be on the same page. So,
thank you.
So now you get the mouthful, Ira.
I've written most of them down.
Right. So tell us about your experience in with municipal budgeting and finance, public procurement, human resources and collective bargaining, grant writing and grant administration, town meeting and warrant preparation, and regionalization services.
In my business, I'm the HR director. I handle procurement. I do finance and budget, capital when it's needed. We don't write grants. There's no collective bargaining. I know about regionalization, and there's certainly not a warrant or a preparation for town meeting. My experience on the public side of things and my government experience, of course, is all not hands-on, or primarily not hands-on. It's from the board perspective. Over the years, it's kind of evolved more into policy setting and, you know, board level oversight. In terms of HR, I've been involved with wage and class studies, being involved on a was actually just prior to my being elected to the Select Board, where there was a wage and class study that was done that was on an ad hoc basis. In terms of finance budget, and I'll throw capital in there as well, as I mentioned, I spent 6 years on the Finance Committee, 10 on the School Committee, the remainder of my time on the Select Board, so I've seen it from many different angles. In terms of capital, I've spent the last 10 years on our Capital Planning Committee, so we do have a 5-year plan. It's always evolving and always changing, and the target never quite stands still. Something we did that was very interesting that give our town administrator a tremendous amount of credit for is, as you know, and as is typical in most communities, whether you have a capital plan or not, capital expenditures typically are left for last if there happens to be money left over. And by the way, I said this to the screening committee when I interviewed there, the amount of free cash, reserve funds, stabilization funds that you have here in Deerfield as a percentage of your budget are really impressive. Significant. And really, really impressive. You know, the rule of thumb is you want to be anywhere from 5% to maybe north of 10% when you add all of those funds together, and you guys are way above that. So you're to be commended, and I think your finance committee and all the people and certainly the departments that, from the sense I get, is count a lot of pennies and pinch a lot of pennies are to be commended for that. But getting back to capital, so sometimes we got to spend what we actually wanted to spend, but more often than not, there were things that were left on the table and were not funded. Something that we did a couple of years ago is when it was implemented is what we've termed a rolling debt program. So we would typically spend $500,000 or so annually in capital articles on either an annual or a special town meeting. Sometimes more, occasionally less, but that's probably a pretty good number. We put in place a plan to spend $7.5 million over a period of 7 to 10 years. It went through bond council, and it was divided into specific categories, specific segments, roads, sidewalks. For the very first time in South Hadley, we're actually spending local money to improve roads and sidewalks and not just relying on whatever pittance the state gives us. Recreation, buildings. So there were four or five different categories. And the idea is that without doing anything in terms of an override or, all within the tax levy limit, we've been able to begin spending that money on an annual basis. It was approved in advance by our town meeting. Some folks in town meeting, after it was approved and we started down this path, said, oh, we did that? Oops. But it's actually worked very well, and it's allowed us to budget that money up front so that it's right in the center of the radar screen and nobody can forget about it, and it's there, and it's approved. So the idea is that over time, again, 7 to 10 years, we've got this money that's going to be spent. It's going to be spent in specific categories. Some were identified up front. Others have changed and over the time. But we're about a third of the way through the expenditure portion, and as we spend more, we begin to pay back. So we've been using State House notes to this point, I believe. And at some point, within the next several months, we'll go out to bond either with State House notes if the rate's right, or some other mechanism to be able to borrow, not for decades and decades, but for relatively short periods of time, and pay back and kind of pay as we go. But it's provided us with a discipline. I got a little long-winded there. Collective bargaining. More recently, I think if you go back 20 or 25 years, I think it was very typical that boards, whether it's on the municipal side or the school side, would actually sit in negotiations, and I have a lot of experience doing that. In more recent times, I think the trend has been more to allowing the administrator, whether it's, again, on schools or the municipal side of government, to handle that with direction from the board. But I have that's one of the areas where I do have a fairly extensive amount of experience with what were very tough negotiations at times, and then much more collaborative negotiations. Grant writing, I've written some grants. I haven't written the big grants. I agree with Natasha that there's a lot of input that's required from a lot of different places to write good grants. One of the things that I've seen in my community is that when you collaborate with other entities, whether it's another department, whether it's something more on a regional basis, say with the Pioneer Valley Planning Commission, or in our case, the Hampshire Council of Governments, or simply with another community, that quite often that has put some teeth into the application, and we've been actually, I think, fairly successful. It's important that every community get their fair share of what's there. In communities of this size and larger, it's very difficult to have, I mean, certainly you can't afford to have the resources to be able to write great grants in-house. And that's where I assume the Franklin COG comes into play. They have grant writing services, and it's important that in Deerfield, as in with any other community, that that's really front and center, and you're taking the opportunity whenever possible to step up. There are times when it's important not to apply for a grant. You know, you don't want to you want to have some credibility over time. So you want to make sure that if you're going to apply for a grant, that there's a reasonable chance that it's going to be approved. Regionalization, you guys live regionalization. I mean, I can see it with Sunderland and Waitley, Conway, with the Franklin Council of Governments. There's no way for communities of this size to do half of what you do without that. In our community, we're a little bit bigger, and oftentimes I find that people feel that, oh, we can do it ourselves. We're kind of right on that cusp of, and I think regionalization is very important, not only community to community, but within the community. Opportunities, for instance, for the municipality and the schools, even though it's a regional school system, doesn't matter. So, you know, to be able to look for areas where there's commonality, where there's where you can work together, save money, and provide better service, should absolutely be done. Something that I've pushed for and not been successful so far is in terms of technology and really partnering with the school system and the municipality to make that work. It's all the same technology, it's all the same stuff. You know, the applications are different, but it doesn't matter, in my estimation. Warrant preparation. So I've approved warrant. You know, I've signed warrants and voted on warrants. It's really just the nuts and bolts of, in terms of preparing the warrant, running it through town council, making sure that everything is done properly. Also, from the communication perspective, making sure that well in advance of certainly the annual town meeting, but even more importantly, any special town meeting that's coming up, that all the constituents, particularly within government, know that a town meeting is coming up and that they be urged to look and to see if there's anything that they need to ask to be placed on that warrant so that it can be as complete as possible. I think I covered most of it.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
And Casey, what would you do in your first 2 weeks in the position?
I think I would observe and listen, like Ira said. Yeah. There's a wealth of knowledge in the people that will be coming in to voice their opinions, the people that you work with, and certainly the people that you work for. So being able to parse through that and find the pieces of this puzzle that are going to pop up and become priorities and steer the ship in some ways. I think many times collaborating simply by gathering people together and saying, what's going on? You know, what is going on in your office that is having an effect in another office? Or what's going on with this project? Is that going to be something that I'm going to need to see moving forward in a different direction 3 months from now? People have a lot of stuff on their plate. However, it really is useful to give them a chance to talk to you, but also to listen to what they have to say. And again, it starts with the select board as well, because you have a list of priorities. They may not be written down, but they're a list of priorities based on your experiences as selectmen, but also as residents of the town of Deerfield. And people come to you where they sometimes wouldn't come to the office. That's going to bring a certain amount of information and a certain amount of, a certain ability to, I like to call it driving the bus on a particular project or something that isn't a project. So the first 2 weeks is really gathering information, finding out where the staff is, certainly approaching the committees, because the committees have different meeting schedules, and let's face it, everybody works. When you're on a committee, you work too. Making those inroads to meeting with them can sometimes be a little more challenging, so that might not happen in the first 2 weeks. But reaching out and communicating that you do want to sit down and have that interaction is almost more important than being able to hammer out a date. So from that sense, I think I would need to gather some information and really give people the opportunity to talk to me.
Thank you.
And Natasha. What are your thoughts on performance evaluations, and what process would you follow to set objectives and monitor the performance?
So, echoing my two counterparts over here, I would say performance evaluations are very important if done constructively. I think emotions get into play a lot of the time. So, you know, I would definitely look at the template that Deerfield utilizes and, you know, get feedback from all of the employees to see if they think the form, whatever form that is, works for them, or if they have suggestions for improvement. I know with my experience for the town of Columbia, the form was extremely basic. A lot of people didn't feel it met the needs of the organization. It was just too general. And the rating scale is always controversial, if you should have a rating scale at all. We had a lot of people that were concerned about why they got a 4 instead of a 5. And then everyone would confer with their counterparts in the office and find out that so-and-so got a 5 and they got a 4. And I think it gets rather emotional. So I think finding a way to make it more constructive, I think having parts in the form where it's more feedback oriented, an open format, shall you say, with open text of, you know, I saw Mary work on this project and she got X, Y, and Z done, and she got it done on time, and she worked with her fellow employees, to make sure that you're not just putting a number down and not really defining what that number means. And always saying there's room for improvement. I think people always want to get the 5. So where is the room for improvement? Not everyone always does everything perfectly. And I think that's something that needs to be made aware when you're putting this performance evaluation together. Everyone can always improve. You can always learn something new on the job. You can always do something better, myself included. That being said, the 360 reviews I have found, if done appropriately, can be very good. I had one done that was not, it was a little bit inappropriate. I would change that in the way that, you know, anonymous reviews have their place, but I think it allows people to say whatever they want to say without any constructive criticism. It's more of personal attacks, which, you know, should definitely be avoided in the public sector. I think focusing on goals and tasks and how they're met is very, very important. So I would want to hear from the employees how they feel I am doing on certain projects, you know, and certain timelines and certain things that we're trying to meet. And how I would develop those processes is get input from the employees and what they want to see on the form. I would also make suggestions on all of the forms I've seen used. And then we would create our own if we decide that that is needed. If the form that is being utilized now is perfectly fine, that's great. But, you know, that's your basis. And then if a performance improvement plan needs to be set up sometime during the year where you find that you've set up 5 to 10 goals and you're going to meet them on certain dates and that's not happening, find out why. You know, we call them PIPs, performance improvement plans. But setting up those progress meetings, you know, the manager, the administrator role gets very, very busy, but it's important to set aside time, especially if there's something going on in a department that's not working, to step in and say, hey, how is this going? Like the face-to-face time, because once a year is not enough. I don't know if I could do 3 to 4 times a year. I think we get bogged down so much. It would be fantastic if you could do it once a quarter, which would be great. But I think twice a year at the minimum is a good way to do it. You know, kind of halfway say, are we meeting it? And then why aren't we? And how can I help you meet your goal? Because that's part of the problem, you know, is feeling like you're on your own with your goals. And, you know, how are you going to get assistance from the manager in meeting those? So,
thank you. Ira, how would you go about assessing the strengths and weaknesses of this organization and identify opportunities to improve?
I'm starting to sound a bit like a broken record.
I know.
But again, it's a lot of listening, a lot of asking questions, and a lot of reaching out internally and externally and looking for opportunities to get feedback in places that maybe wouldn't be quite so typical. The most important thing, again, that an organization has to understand and has to agree to adhere to is understanding and working very, very hard at what the core competencies are of the organization and not moving away from that unless there's an incredibly compelling reason to do so and to just work every day to be excellent at what those core competencies are. Coming from the private sector and with my business, customer satisfaction is the most important thing. Whether you make a sale or not is less important than having a satisfied visitor. So if it's a visitor to the tax collector's office, if it's a visitor to the library, if it's a visitor anywhere, having the organization understand that that's part of the core competency to provide excellent service and to satisfy the needs, the reasonable needs of the customers, of the visitors, of the constituents. So I don't know if that totally answers your question, but that would be my answer to it.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Casey, so how do you set priorities? What do you see as the most pressing issues facing the town of Deerfield?
I think that depends entirely on how much information you can gather in the first 2 weeks you're here. Mm. There are things that Deerfield is facing, like the bridge, but there are other infrastructure issues that are key to, I think, the next probably year to 5 years, depending on what everyone sees in the budget as how do you best utilize the money from a capital perspective. There are several buildings that will need to be maintained and or dealt with somehow. I do think that there's other pieces of the puzzle with relation to the human element, both on the school side and on the town side. Interactions, perhaps, with Frontier and the superintendent that could help facilitate the budget process in a smoother manner. And certainly working with the committees on a holistic basis to have them communicate their priorities, because ultimately those priorities encompass the town's priorities. But from an economic perspective, Deerfield is in a strong position, economically speaking, but there's room for improvement and there's opportunity out there. And there are organizations like DEDIC, Deerfield Economic Development Industrial Corporation, that can assist the town, that have that particular group has the ability to share resources, and reaching out to them and facilitating better communication and a working relationship that is a hand-in-hand one could be very useful to setting the priorities and then putting a plan into place. In Deerfield, there's a very strong educational element, particularly in Old Deerfield, that though can be a resource from a financial perspective, I think it's more important from an interpersonal perspective to understand their goals and be able to work with them proactively to have them help the town, but also to help them. They have their own set of challenges that perhaps we can assist with. So that's a priority that I think that kind of communication would be really useful. But there are some larger infrastructure issues, like the wastewater treatment plant, that a plan needs to be developed, and I think that's in process. However, the pieces to that plan need to probably be ironed out to some extent, because often when there's a large infrastructure project, there's the need to fund it, and funding is very likely the scariest thing that any resident wants to hear about. Mm-hmm. So from that perspective, I think those are the things that come to mind right away, but I do suspect there's other things that won't come to light until the question's asked. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. There is one last question that I'm going to ask of everyone at the same time, but I would like to announce, as long as everybody's attention is here, is that they have started work on the Stillwater Bridge. And I want to thank Kevin very much for long hours and collaborative outreach to the Department of Transportation to make this happen. It's very exciting that it is actually going to be completed, hopefully, by the end of the month, if not sooner. But it's Kevin is really deserves an awful lot of credit. So anyway, so our final question from us as a select board, and Wendy, I think Wendy has some afterwards, but Natasha, why should we hire you?
That's a good question. I think the reason that Deerfield should hire me is that I bring an energy that's insane. I have such a strong passion for local government, which started at an early age, you know, being a volunteer firefighter since technically before I was allowed to at age 16. That's what got me into this. I said I need to help people, and I think that's ultimately what we're here to do, is to help the residents of Deerfield and continue to make this community a great place to live. And, you know, I saw that in trying to figure out what a town manager did and a town administrator did, working on my thesis in undergrad, being able to interview all of these managers that I selected, and hearing about their experiences just made me want to do it more. You're dealing with something different every day, and that's the best part about the job. You're never going to see me bored. You're never going to see me not working 100% and doing everything that needs to be done and not leaving my desk until it's done. You know, everyone would always tell me, after meetings at 10 o'clock at night, go home. So you always will get that 100% work ethic from me, and I think that's something that I have to offer. And the only other thing I would mention is honesty. I will always tell you what's on my mind within reason, trying to be tactful with that as well. But I've never been into the more political aspect, which is why, I guess, as we were using the terminology before, sitting on this side of the table, and no offense to the select board, but there are different mindsets between myself and any kind of select board. And I think you're always going to get hard work and honesty from me, and open, clear communication. I'm always going to tell it like it is.
Thank you. So, Ira, the same question. Why should we hire you?
I bring a set of experiences and a background that is about as diverse in this context as it could possibly be. For more than 30 years, I have been self-employed. I get a paycheck when I get it right, and I don't get a paycheck when I get it wrong. So the buck, so to speak, has stopped with me and my wife in running our business for all of that time. Thankfully, we've gotten it right more than we've gotten it wrong. Our four children appreciate that as well. So I bring that whole set of experiences in combination with all of my experience over the last 25 plus years in local government. I think I have something to offer the town of Deerfield that will be somewhat different from perhaps other candidates because of those experiences and because of the perspective that I bring. I think that the community that I come from in South Hadley has many things that in common, although we're a larger community, many things in common with Deerfield and share having to work on many of the same sorts of issues. The nonprofit untaxed educational community in Deerfield is significant. It is in South Hadley as well. Dealing with open space, retaining the small town rural character of this community, at the same time trying to balance that with maintaining and improving the business climate in order to grow the community the right way. Those are all things that are that are very similar between our two communities, and I think I can bring a perspective not only from where I live, but my experiences throughout the state, being involved with state organizations, the school committee organization years ago, more recently the MMA, Selectmen's Association, that sort of thing. I have a very good network of individuals that I can call on. I don't even need to say it, but I will. I haven't sat behind the desk and done most of the mechanical things that a town administrator does. I've observed quite a bit of it, but not actually done it. And there's going to be a little bit of a learning curve to understand that. So early on in this interview, when I talked about being a mentor and also a mentee, that's part of that. But I'm a quick study. I'm an extremely hard worker. 12-hour and 15-hour days is what I've done for my entire career, and I wouldn't expect it to be any different here. So I am, number one, honored that I was invited here to talk with you, and would be very honored if you were to make the choice to hire me as your town administrator.
Thank you. Thank you, Ira. Casey, why should we hire you?
I have a great deal of experience in municipal government, but not the least of which is in Deerfield. And I do have some knowledge of some of the challenges that have faced the town in the past. I have a strong commitment to collaborative management and to communication and to facilitating the best communication that can be had based on the circumstances. I do have a high work ethic. I'm one of those people that doesn't leave as early as I probably should. But the reason I do that is because I have high expectations for myself, because what I want to produce as work needs to meet those expectations and ultimately be of help to the town. And one of the biggest understandings that anybody can have working for a town is that it's up to a town administrator to develop information and solutions, facilitate the communication of those solutions, and present that. But the town makes the decision, whether it's residents acting as a select board in this type of meeting or whether it's at town meeting. The residents make those decisions, and that's one of the most important things that we as prospective town administrators need to understand. What we do after is implement them. And that is, I think, one of the strongest ways to understand how I work, and that's what makes me a strong candidate to do that.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Wendy.
Okay. I've received a few questions. If anybody has a question, wants to write it down. So some of them have been answered, I think, when a down cycle comes, where do you see libraries in the hierarchy of need? Maybe just run right through.
Sure.
Okay.
Same deal left, right?
Sure.
Tag, you're right.
So this is a great question that I actually recently grappled with the town of Columbia. The expansion renovation project for that library for Columbia got shot down 3 times. Before it actually succeeded. It started as a really large expansion and it just kept getting smaller and smaller. I think because this question a lot of people disagreed on. I came in with a certain opinion and my opinion was changed after the year that I worked there. You know, I obviously am in the more technological age. I have not visited a library in quite some time because information is readily available at our fingertips online. That doesn't say that libraries have no place anymore. I think libraries have understood that things are just transforming. So they're offering different materials in libraries now, not just books. A lot of electronic materials are now being provided. So I think there's definitely a place for libraries for the rest of time, because having a book in your hand, I mean, that there's no other experience like it. Yes, of course, we have our Kindles and all of that lovely stuff these days, but I think having libraries, maintaining them, and making sure they're keeping up with the resources is important, to making sure there's, whether it be books on tape or electronic media, having an internet cafe. Some people don't have access to Wi-Fi. That's probably one of the biggest things that libraries are focusing on now, is making sure that the electronic media is there. And, you know, I would be very excited to work on the library project that's coming up for the town of Deerfield, because I feel as though I've muddled through a lot of the issues that came across as we were designing the building and as we were thinking about what it was going to offer the residents. So.
The role of libraries in the community has changed dramatically over time. I wouldn't think of shortchanging funding for the library or giving that recommendation any more than I would think about not mowing the lawn on the town square, because that's what libraries are. They have become a meeting place, the community square, and a place to exchange ideas and a place to do research and all of the other things that traditionally libraries do. But more important than anything, it's become a place where the community meets. In South Hadley, we just a couple of years ago finished a $10 million library that, beyond just all of the things that I just mentioned, has been become and is identified as one of the real cornerstones of what we hope to be urban renewal through a redevelopment program that's being put in place in South Hadley Falls in the south end of town, the industrial part of town. It is the most active government building by a long shot in the community, other than, of course, the schools. From a purely practical point of view, the library lobby in Boston has to be incredible, because there's a law, law regulation, there's a rule that if you underfund from year to year libraries by more than, I think it might be 5%, it's been a while since I've looked at it, but if you don't fund libraries up to a certain level, then you lose lots of other things. So, you know, there have been instances, maybe even here in Deerfield, I don't know, but certainly in other communities, where the library budget was proposed to be cut, and ultimately they just don't get cut, because when you cut it, then you lose a lot of those other services that are regional and statewide services that libraries participate in.
Thank you.
Do you want me to repeat the question, or you?
Could you?
All right. The question is, when a down cycle comes, where do you see libraries in the hierarchy of needs?
First and foremost, many of the libraries around here are historical buildings. And in a down cycle, often we have this question of how to fit this type of assessment into what the rest of the needs of the town are. But really, a library is a social and a learning space. It has changed. It's no longer just about reading books. It's about gathering and sharing ideas and admiring the space that these libraries are, because many of them are just beautiful buildings. But in a downturn, one has to balance not only the operational budget needs of a library, but the preservation needs of a library. And I think the best thing anybody can do is try to facilitate that understanding, because it can get lost in the shuffle of maybe thinking, well, it's the library. What's the more critical thing out there? No, a library has a critical piece of a social structure in a town. And sometimes it's the first government building that a person walks into. So I think it's an important place.
I just want to do a check with the board in terms of how many more questions, how much time, because we did say, I think, 7:30.
Go ahead.
Okay. All right, here's a different kind of question from it. Interested in hearing your thoughts about the balance of power between the town administrator and the select board. How about Ira, would you like to start?
Sure. As I said earlier this evening, every community is different. What's most important is that the roles and responsibilities of both be clearly identified, clearly articulated, and understood and adhered to. My personal preference and the way I have viewed my role sitting where you are for many years is for the board to act primarily as in the private sector, a board of trustees, as an oversight board, setting policy, giving direction, and allowing the professionals, whether it's the town administrator or any of the other departments and the folks that head those departments, the opportunity to and expect that, you know, those jobs are going to be done. You've certainly been, you know, very recently, you know, you've had had to take a very different role than that, for sure.
And that's why you're here tonight.
So I think most importantly, it's a matter of everybody understanding what the roles are, and having a connection and an understanding that's going to allow the job to get done. Thank you.
I think there is an understanding both on the town administrator's from the town administrator's perspective and from the select board perspective that it's operational, but it's also the select board has a higher goal of determining policy. And what often can be very useful is if the select board can outline the goal and obtain information and tools to reach that goal, that can be very useful. But often politics gets in the way. So sometimes the role of the town administrator and the select board changes as certain challenges appear. So I think it has to be somewhat fluid, just based on the players, based on the atmosphere, based on the challenges. But ultimately, ideally, the town administrator should be able to handle the operational elements of running the town hall and helping the other departments reach their goals. But the select board has a large part to play in the policy oversight that allows those operations to succeed.
Do you need me to repeat the question? Or
no. Okay. This is actually a question I actually had for the three of you. This is the number one struggle I dealt with at my last job. And I will say that matter-of-factly, number one struggle. The roles were not clearly identified at my last job. I think you get a job description and you follow that to the best of your ability, but sometimes there are gray lines. Columbia was unique in that we were one of the few municipalities in the state of Connecticut that did not have a true full-time town administrator. The first selectman had a part-time role, 10 hours a week. So I think that provided some of the cloudiness. And I think I've learned a great deal from that experience, and that having weekly meetings, if possible, if it has to be by the phone or in person with the chairman or the chair of the board, whatever the title is for that select board, and making sure you're on the same page. Because duplicative efforts is not good for the taxpayers. You can't have someone doing the same thing that you're doing over here. And having the town administrator not be aware of what's going on is also not a good thing. I think sometimes, you know, it's not out of malicious intent. I think it's just that obviously we're all very excited, I think, to be here and to be doing what we're doing, and that we get passionate about certain efforts and projects. But sometimes, you know, running with that and not making sure everyone's involved is a problem. But making sure that communication aspect is out there is the number one role. You know, I've seen that Deerfield did a study in 2013 with the professional consultant, and they made 9 recommendations. You know, and part of my question was, you know, how many of those recommendations have been implemented? I know a couple have, but one of which was, you know, their opinion was that, you know, kind of what was said before, letting the manager, the professional, do the job and having the board be more of an advisory role. And I do feel as though that's worked. I've seen that work very well, and would hope that that would be how Deerfield would operate as well. I think the manager or the administrator's role is to synthesize the data and make the board aware of the things that they need to be aware of. I don't need to call the three of you up and let you know that there was a small HR issue between two employees. You know, that's something that's operational that you deal with yourself in-house, unless it's becoming a larger issue with a union or what have you. But, you know, to make sure that you're setting the monthly agenda or biweekly agenda and making sure that we're on the same page,
It can't be said enough, and not just with the chair, with the entire board, because, you know, sitting down and setting those goals at the beginning and understanding how each of us are going to contribute to that, and what your desires are, because sometimes I can get energetic and run with things and I should be focusing on something else instead. So that's, you know, making sure that we're continuously keeping that communication role.
I have a few more, but how about just one more? Is that all right?
Yeah.
Okay. Sorry. The senior center is shared. We have a senior center right here, and it's in Deerfield, but it is serving people in Whately and Sunderland as well. I don't know how long. It's been a long time since you've had the operation here. How would you work with the other town administrators and select boards to meet the needs of the seniors and the serving that are being served by the senior center?
My approach would be to work with the other town administrators and the director to develop goals and figure out what the seniors want, because the seniors will make it known what they want, especially if they are encouraged. So getting that data from the director, sitting down and discussing the best way to approach that, then communicating that with the oversight committee is a good approach to handling that, and that's been successful for me in the past. But certainly it has a lot to do with what the other administrators can contribute in terms of time. Doing that on a regular basis would be even more helpful, just because it allows us to keep up to date with what changing needs may have happened, programs that could come up, or other types of things that we could provide the seniors that would better help them.
I'm trying to switch it off here, Natasha.
I think having a collaborative effort with the different services that are involved in the Senior Center is very wise. What I found successful at the Senior Center in Columbia is that we had a subgroup of folks that just met for, it was called a Hunger Action Committee, and we had a semi-food pantry within the Senior Center, and that was something that was kind of a Connecticut thing in that, you know, we were looking for more food pantries. So trying to work with your neighboring towns to decide who is going to be the player and what and where the money is coming from. I don't know how much money the two towns are providing currently right now to run the Senior Center, but I think time and effort is a big thing that you have to consider with, you know, the services. If you want to provide, I know our senior center director at Columbia when I worked there was really, really passionate. She tried to come up with new activities every week. And that takes time. So, I mean, if you're going to have help from the other two towns, that's one thing. You know, meeting with those managers and those directors to kind of get a list of ideas they might have on their mind, saying we want to provide a newsletter, we want to do a monthly, you know, dance for the seniors, or we want to, we did a lot of IT work, we brought in students to work with the seniors on how to use a computer, or whatever it might be, you know, having a game night, making sure that you're capturing all those ideas from the other towns, making sure that, you know, we're not just focusing on Deerfield, but that we have the other towns' interests in mind. And, you know, kind of echoing what I said before with getting input from the residents on the budget or what they feel is working in town, likewise, same with what you would do for the seniors, maybe having a day where you invite them to have a cup of coffee and say, what are some programs you'd like to see, you know, from the other two towns as well as Deerfield, and just continuously working on that. Maybe I meant to mention before, I think, you know, surveys can be helpful. Maybe if it's just a very short one, you know, you have a couple boxes that you check and say, you know, what do you think, what do you want, put it in a box, and then kind of collaborate with the other directors or managers in that way. And yeah, I think just it's kind of everything that we've been echoing, the collaboration aspect. So,
thank you. I would expect that there's some kind of a document that was written when the Regional Senior Center was put in place. You're nodding, so I guess that's the case. That should be reviewed regularly, if not annually, at least every two or three years. And it should be signed off on by each of the communities that are involved. I think this doesn't have to be difficult. And certainly Deerfield, you know, you have lots of experience with collaborating with other communities on regional services of all types, from, you know, emergency management to schools to, you know, on and on. And if there are some issues that are maybe not working entirely well for one of those regional enterprises, maybe looking at the other regional enterprises and taking some of the best practices of those, some of the things that are working well that maybe have some crossover to a different, you know, to this, in this case, the senior center, might be something good to look at. You've got the same basic set of communities that you collaborate with a lot, so I would expect that there's already a fairly high level of understanding and communication between the communities. I like Natasha's idea of doing a periodic survey. Mm-hmm. You know, certainly the senior population is will be very accommodating in giving feedback when it comes to that. So I'm not sure exactly where the question is coming from in terms of if there are particular issues, but you know, certainly I think it's something that there are basic categories of services that senior centers pretty much everywhere provide, whether it's delivery of you know, food service delivery, medical, recreation. You know, there's probably five or six different categories, and if those are viewed appropriately and then broken down into, you know, specific activities or subservices that are offered, I think it's very handleable.
Thank you.
That's a word.
Thank you.
We did have a few more.
Oh, okay.
But I
just wonder if you wanted to take.
We've been grueling people for 2 hours. Plus.
Is there anything that's a little bit different than what we asked?
Well, the only one, and I know that's a question that wanted to be asked, was about economic development. Perhaps you noticed the empty storefronts in the South Deerfield area. Want me to continue
sure.
with this?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
The closed fun. Businesses in town. What would your role be?
I'll go first if you like.
I would
go first. the community's role, and specifically, well, government's role, is very, very important when it comes to economic development. It's something that we've dealt with for years and years and years. And the master plan that was done in South Hadley, which identified the specific need for an economic development director, we still haven't done that. Fortunately, we have a town administrator that has very good expertise and a very good track record in terms of reaching out and looking for opportunities, sometimes that are just, you know, it's there, it's a program, take advantage of it, make it happen. Sometimes it's something that's a little bit out of the box. But while municipal government certainly don't have a lot of money to throw at these sorts of things, we certainly have the infrastructure to be able to help and to look for ways to help business and at the same time to help the community. So always looking for ways to attract business, to focus on what the needs of business are, and to, as much as possible, be known as a place that welcomes business can be nothing but positive. And it's something that every community should be doing, and sadly, not all do. I see it as a big role for the town administrator.
Okay, can I go?
You can go if you want.
I would definitely agree with that. The last place I worked for Columbia as town administrator, unfortunately, they had a business unfriendly reputation, and that mainly stemmed from the Land Use and Building Department. Not saying that it was the employees who were being rude or anything like that. It was just that we had regulations in place that were not helping. And you know, regulations are in place for a reason. We can't just run around and do whatever we want. But at the same time, they were too restrictive. And so I viewed my role while being there as a facilitator. So I met, while I was there, I went out and individually met with business owners. And they said that that was the first time a town administrator had ever sat down and talked to them. And I think that's where sometimes maybe in certain towns that there's a gap. We kind of view it as two different worlds, as Ira has been saying, private sector versus public sector. And I think that that's where governments fail at times, is that we have to understand that if we're not supporting the businesses, we're not supporting our tax base. We had far more vacancies in Columbia than you do here, so you're not that bad off. But I think making sure that your setbacks are not too restrictive, making sure that you're not, your sign regulations are a big thing. If you can't know where the business is and what they're doing, that's a big problem. Sometimes it's due to traffic volume restrictions, what businesses can come in. You know, I'm sure on certain areas of town, you know, you couldn't put a CVS or you couldn't put, you know, a larger chain, and that might not be something that the residents want either. I think having a survey, which we did, to see what businesses you want to see in town. A lot of the time when you try to do a gap analysis with a professional consultant, it's really expensive, like a realtor kind of company. So if you can do your own and see, you know, do we have enough restaurants? Is that what we need to get? Or do we have enough pharmacies? We pretty much didn't have anything in Columbia. We had a Chinese restaurant and a realtor's office and a hair cutting place, and everything else was pretty much, you know, so it was a big challenge. The only large one that we had was Ford, which obviously Ford brings in a lot of jobs, and it was a very successful business. But the sign regulations, we had a business almost threatened to leave town because they had a mural on the side of their building, and we don't have an art district. So it was technically against regulations because it was outside the measurements, and we had to make them take it down because it was promoting their business. It's that kind of thing where I wish there was ways to soften things in government a little bit and make it, it's hard to make exceptions because then you're making exceptions to the rule and then others can argue. But I think the role of the administrator is to maybe make recommendations via the town planner and the building department to say, are there things that we can soften a little bit or make a little bit different to accommodate businesses, to make it easier for them. It shouldn't be a struggle to set up a business. Absolutely. One of those things is making information available. If it isn't already there, a business's page, how to set up a business in Deerfield and how to make it thrive. You know, just yep. Making that communication between the town easy.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
To echo what Natasha said, there's a growing need to actually go back and review what towns have for bylaws that may restrict business. But there's also a growing need to reach out to the other resources that exist in the area. There are planning commissions out there. There's the COG out there, the Franklin Regional Council of Governments. There are resources that town administrators can reach out to help develop a plan to even bring people to the table. We also have a great deal of space and promoting that space and really getting people to understand what's available in Deerfield and how we can best craft something that works for the town. So that's a collaborative effort internally and externally. Internally, it would be between a number of constituents, not the least of which would be the planning board, the zoning board, the select board, and really committing to growing business in town, not to the exclusion of the other important aspects of Deerfield, which is its scenic vistas, the farming community, and the historic nature of the town. So there's got to be a balance in there as well.
Great, thank you.
Great.
I think what we're going to do is take this under advisement and have an opportunity to
discuss it, sure.
Yeah. Would that be all right?
Sounds good.
Okay.
Any questions that you
have? Yeah. Do you have any questions
you might have?
I can start if you want.
Sure.
Make sure I remember my top two.
Well, I think the typical question that is asked, but I think is important, since you've been asking us, you know, what our strengths and weaknesses are and what our experience is, you know, I guess I'd like to hear maybe one or two traits, characteristics, or skills that you feel the next town of Deerfield administrator needs to have to be successful.
Shoot.
Well, I think it's really important that we have outreach into the community. And I mean, a lot of the things you talked about, you know, it's really important that people feel valued and that no matter how small their problem is, I feel it's very important that their problem gets addressed somehow. I mean, sometimes there's no way that you can address some issues, but you need to listen. And so being empathetic probably is really important to me. And I mean, we are a small town, and the reason why I volunteer is because I truly want to make a difference and make people feel how important our community is. And so it is important to me that the town administrator reaches out to the community on a regular basis, but also just answers questions and concerns and as best as possible, and then transmits that to us. I know you said you referred to, you know, professional report. We had state people come in here and tell us that we needed a professional manager, and you know, they're coming from larger communities and they want us to spend more money and have more disconnect with our community. I don't agree with that. So no, we have not done that. If I just wanted to be a rubber stamp, I wouldn't be a selectman. There's no reason. I have better things to do. But I think it's also important that we have a system that deals and that our town runs efficiently and effectively. We are conservative. We try very, very hard to manage our money really well. It's a constant struggle because you have a pie that's not getting very much bigger, and there's more and more demands for that. And a lot of that is out of our control. I mean, close to 70% of our budget is school-related somehow, whether it's charter schools or Smith Voc or special ed or just regular school budgets. And so it's very frustrating to chase every single penny and spend an inordinate amount of time scrambling for money. We write grants ourselves. We participate in grants. And it's really hard to generate that every dollar, look for every dollar, and then not be able to work with the schools to try to, you know, keep their costs under control. But at the same time, it's important to have a good relationships with the schools because the schools are caught. When I started years and years ago, the state was paying about 30% of cost, you know, and it did bump up for a couple of years. We were up to like 35% of the cost of educating a child was covered by the state. We're down to like 20%, and the costs are, you know, much higher now. Mm-hmm. So the town is bearing much more of a burden, and everybody's, you know, town government as well as schools is labor intensive. So, you know, there's a lot of tension about budget time because everybody's scrambling to preserve their piece of the pie, and it's really important that the town administrator work through that part of the process. I mean, I feel like it's a year-round struggle for us to do the budget. It's a constant thing. But we're on top of our money, and I think we're in the good position that we are because we are on top of it constantly. Mm-hmm. But it would be lovely to have a town administrator to do some of the burden of that, because that is really tough. So I don't know if you guys want to add.
I would add, you know, you all mentioned it tonight too, is but collaboration for sure and communication. It would be wonderful to have. We have wonderful department heads. This town is run very well by its department heads, and so just that coordination with them, getting as much information to us, because of open meeting law, we can't meet or discuss or find out really what's going on in town with each other, and especially without a town administrator, it's really hard to know what we need to deal with. So having that person in that seat will be so vital, and to be able to communicate with the department heads and funnel that through us so that we can, you know, really know when a resident comes up to us with an issue, they feel like we know what's going on, and we, you know, we have a plan for it, and we're working on this. A lot of what we find in town is, you know, either just nobody knows really what's happening. So a communication conduit out to the residents and then through this board will be very, very much appreciated. That's kind of where I'm at.
All of those things are very important, but I look at this a little bit differently. I've only been here 6 months, but I've been self-employed for 44 years. And all of my life, I've been driving down a road and there's a boulder in front of me. And I've had to learn to go around it. Well, when I came to this position, I've learned that's not a phrase you can use. How do you get around this? How do you get around that? Now I've learned, how do you work within the rules? And my point of view for a town administrator is someone who knows the rules. And if you don't know the rules, you have to know where to find the rules, find the answers. Because the decisions that the town administrator makes incorrectly can cost the community greatly. And if we make errors along the way, you know, it's a long-term effect. And I think it's very important that whoever gets this job, I'm not expecting them to know everything, but I'm expecting them to find the answers, you know. And that's, and to me, I do a lot of research. I mean, we do have a town council. I consult with my own lawyer more than the town council. I spend more hours on my computer emailing the attorney generals, the inspector generals, and all these other, because I want to know the answers. You know, DOR, why do we have to do this? Why not? You know, and it's important to know the answers, and that's how I come at this job.
I just had two questions. One has been asked, and Ms. Ness said, gave an answer. I'd be interested in if either of the other members have an opinion on that 2013 DOR report. So that's my first question.
I would take that a little bit. Again, I'm fairly new to the board and to town politics at all. So, you know, part of it is I don't know what I don't know. And I think, you know, I'm still out on that question a little bit. It really depends on who's sitting in the town administrator seat and what kind of capacity they have. If they can pick up the ball and run with it and run that town well, you know, run this town well and communicate, again, back to communication, and as Kip said, you know, keep us out of trouble and know the answer and find the answers for us. And I would tend to give a lot more leeway. I mean, not that I have much control anyways, but just, you know what I mean? I'm open to that town administrator position being stronger if it's in a capable hands, for sure. If that makes any sense.
It does, but that's a tricky and loaded question. Here I go back from instead of the boulder in the road is, if I instruct an employee to do something and it turns out wrong, it costs me money. If the employee wings it and screws up, it still costs me money. So I don't like to be a micromanager, but if I see something from the outside, I'm going to let you know. And a prime example was in this room, a little more than a year ago, we were faced with spending a lot of money on a school roof. I tried to explain to the residents how much it would cost, I tried to explain why they should not go to the Mass School Building Authority. I tried and I tried and I tried. Our school administration at the time said, no, this is the way we got to do it. What would you rather do? Pay half of $3 million or pay all of $3 million? So once again, I stood up and I said, the real question is, do you want to spend half of $3 million or do you want to pay all of $700,000? Well, the community voted to spend half of $3 million. So when I became a selectman, I kind of took over the role of supervising the school roof project. And it was a battle. It was a constant battle, fighting over the craziest things that I thought I would never argue about. And what did it come in? It came in like not close to $900,000 under budget. And it still cost the town twice as much as it should have. So it kind of goes back to, I believe we need a strong town administrator, but I don't want somebody that thinks they knows everything, because as much as I know, I'm constantly learning, and I pride myself in that, because I will ask anybody any question to learn something, to make sure I get it done right.
I guess I have to clarify, too. It's not that I have any desire to micromanage, and we have excellent, as Trevor pointed out, we have excellent department heads, so it's not really that. It's facilitating communication and facilitating stuff getting done. But by having, it's just hard to say, because we don't want decisions being made by someone that isn't communicating to us. So if you're a good communicator and you're a good facilitator, then there really isn't a problem. You're probably going to be running everything. But if you start making decisions where people come up on the street and say, what about this and what about that, and you don't know anything about it, that's pretty serious. And we've been through that a couple times, or at least I have. And I think that's, that's not, I mean, how do you explain that? You don't know anything. And so it is really a question of communication and facilitating things getting done and communicating to us. And we have a good relationship with our department heads. So there isn't, in our mind, it's making sure that the town administrators has the skill to make sure that they can do their job better, and we know what's happening. That's all. I mean, it's not really managing. I think most of us feel like there's a lot of things we could be doing with our time than we're spending right now.
Thank you.
Well, you sort of just answered it, but I'll ask. Outside of your regular activities of hiring a town administrator, what are your goals for the next 3 or 4 months? And this is irrespective of the budget, because we know it's looming large.
Well, unfortunately, just getting staff, town administrator, and executive assistant, has got to be the number one priority. And then we are behind already, because as you know, we start the budget season right now. And so we're behind. So quite honestly, just getting through the budget season, it's probably the biggest priority, even though I know you're asking other things. Wendy just wrote a grant for the Pioneer Valley Mosquito District, and hopefully we can get a grant to start that. I think it's really important that it would cover towns from West Springfield all the way up to Greenfield and Montague, and including us. And we need to have data. This is climate change related things. So it would be lovely to if we got the grant, we can start focusing on some of that stuff. We're participating in multiple grants that I've been involved in for riverbank restoration work. And, that's been ongoing for years. And that's critical, because we've been having 100-year storms on a regular basis, and our riparian buffers along the Deerfield River are truly up to 16 feet less. So that means all our infrastructure, roads and other, culverts and stuff like that, are truly at risk. And any kind of an event, it doesn't take much. It's not even going to be a 100-year storm anymore that's going to, flood 5 and 10 and Mill Village and stuff like that. That's very serious. So fortunately, Kevin has been wonderful about working, you know, with the different agencies, federal and state agencies, so that we can replace some of our infrastructure when we have an event. So it's been very helpful, but I don't know.
So a few of my thoughts are seniors. I really want to focus on senior. Well, we have a couple housing issues. We have our EMS housing issue that we're trying to work on, and also our senior housing and senior center, a place for our senior center, because that it's in dire need of repair and help and determined location and what needs to happen there, and then also for, you know, our seniors that really need
services.
Yeah, services, and then also senior housing. You know, we definitely have a need of some people that have a need of, you know, they're in these big houses, they've been in for a very long time, families have moved on, and they're saddled with a huge tax bill, and you know, again, very limited income and can't afford to kind of maintain these things, and need help and need community. So that's kind of my focus. I don't know if it'll be 3 or 4 months, but that's definitely working on that constant.
This is the kind of information that's useful.
Yeah.
What about you, Kip?
My goals in the next 3 or 4 months are to try and move this boulder out of the way so we can get our EMS building in place. The senior center, there's another little boulder there, but we can't touch that boulder right yet.
Yep.
But it's moving in the right direction. My goals for the next 3 or 4 months is to continue to court new industries and businesses to come to town. We have a couple of prospective ones that could be quite changing to this community. And the best part about it is, if you didn't hear it here, you never would even see them. Without cutting services, it would be my goal to actually see our tax rate start going down. And I think that's something that really can be done. And substantially, and it just takes a little bit of hard work and understanding what businesses need and why Deerfield is a good fit for them.
Mm-hmm. Good answer. Anybody has a question?
Well, I had one more if I
sure could.
I just simply would like to know when you expect to make a decision and when you would hope to have somebody on board.
Well, I think we're going to try to make a decision next week. Mm-hmm. And Wendy has to do a little bit of reference checks, but she's her last day that she can work for us at all is the 25th. So we'll hope to have everything wound up by then.
Very quickly.
Very quickly.
Yesterday too soon?
So I really appreciate you spending a lot of time with
Thank
us
you
tonight.
For having us.
Thank you.
And you can see that we're very interested in involved board, and we have a lot of things that we want to accomplish, and a lot of things that are happening, good things. Yep. But we need some help.
Yes, we do.
So thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
It's nice meeting all of you.
Yes, I really appreciate it.